The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Tommy Grimes. Mirrors should reflect a little before they throw back images, or so said a noted French writer. But what is meant by reflection? Is it the indiscriminate throwing back of an exact likeness? Yes, that's what the dictionary says. But doesn't reflection mean also to pause, to ponder, to contemplate? Yes, the dictionary says that too. Obviously, Mr. Webster cannot help us here. We shall have to find our own way out.
Gavri Karja, you have been found guilty of treason.
But I'm innocent.
You were given a fair trial.
I'm not a traitor.
You were seen by witnesses. Do you challenge their honesty?
No, but...
But what, Gavri Karja? But what?
What year is this?
You know what year this is. 1943.
Then that proves I'm innocent. If this is the year 1943, I haven't been born yet.
Our mystery drama, The Old Country, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Paul Hecht. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Gabriel Carson is 32 years old and probably makes $2,000 or $3,000 for each year of his age. And for all I know, even more. What with stock options and bonuses and expense accounts, plus all the other perks of modern business. He is part of a new breed. Or maybe a contemporary aspect of an old one. Sharp, adaptable, perceptive, and predatory. And, of course, he holds today's charismatic passport to financial success. An MBA degree from a prestigious university. And no one at International Acceptance Corporation, perhaps the world's largest conglomerate, knows that he was born Gavri Karja. And that his mother still lives in what is described as an ethnic neighborhood.
For your information, I have never lied about my origins. If I never told anyone, it's because, quite simply, it never occurred to anyone to ask. And I visit my mother every Sunday.
Oh, it's you.
Oh, hi. I would have come earlier, Mama, but I knew you'd be at church.
Mm-hmm.
So, how are you feeling?
All right.
Good.
I'd feel better if I had a son who would come early on a Sunday and take his mother to Mass.
Mama, as soon as I get a chance, I'll do that.
So do it next Sunday.
I can't next Sunday.
Uh-huh. And this time, what's the excuse?
Well, they're sending me to Europe.
Why? What do you know about Europe?
The company has opened a branch in Trieste.
Trieste? Well, it's only 200 miles from your father's village. Oh, listen, Gavri,
Mama, please, it's a business trip. I really have no time.
But it would have made your father so happy.
Mama, I have absolutely no interest in or curiosity about the old country.
Oh, Gavri, I wish I could tell you how wonderful
it is. If it was so wonderful, why did you leave it? Now that I think about it, maybe you never did leave it. I mean, this neighborhood, it's like part of the old country, and... You married a young man who lived next door?
You're saying I shouldn't have married your papa?
I'm saying this neighborhood has been your whole life. You never left it.
And why should I leave it? All my friends, all the people from my old village are here. Here, come, sit down at the table. Look, I have your dinner almost ready.
Mama, when you eat at noon, it's called lunch. Besides, I'm not hungry. Just give me a glass of water so I can take this pill.
Ah, pills again. For what this time? First you take a pill that will make you sleep. Then you take a pill to keep you awake. In the old country, whoever heard of pills? A man was a man. He liked to eat, to drink, play music, dance, enjoy life. Tell me, Gavri, do you enjoy life?
Sure, I enjoy life.
So how can you enjoy life if you don't have a family?
Mama, please, I'm really too busy.
What do you do that you should be so busy? No, why can't I see the busy? Your papa, when he was busy, I could see it. He was building a house. What do you do?
I create situations. Yes,
but where is the house? The pair of shoes?
Mom, I'm not a carpenter. I'm not a shoemaker.
What are you?
I'm a strategic planner.
Well, whatever that is, you don't look happy. A mother knows, and the mother knows why. You don't have a woman of your own.
Mom, I could have a dozen women.
Ah, those are women who could belong to anybody. I mean a woman who belongs to you.
Modern women don't want to belong to a man.
I understand. Therefore, you should marry an old-fashioned woman.
Please, Mama.
A girl from the old country. And I found her for you.
Now, look.
Now, she came here a few years ago. She's even been to college, just like you.
Now, look, Mama.
And it hasn't spoiled her. She teaches school. And here she is now. Ah, Neda, come in, my child.
Uncle Mylon said you wanted these shoes right away, so I... Oh.
And Neda, I want you to meet my son, Gavri. Gavri, this is Neda, Neda Benko.
How do you do?
How do you do, Mr. Karja?
No, that is not his name. What is it you call yourself, Gavri?
Carson.
Mr. Carson.
Neda, come. Please, sit down. You have some dinner with us?
Oh, I have to prepare lunch for Uncle Mylon. It was nice meeting you, Mr. Carson.
Miss Benko?
Goodbye.
Mama, did you tell that girl I would be here?
Why should I tell her? Did I tell you?
You placed both of us in an extremely embarrassing situation.
I did it for a reason. I wanted you to fall in love.
I simply don't understand you.
Sometimes when two people meet without warning, see each other for the first time, it's as if lightning strikes.
Mama, I...
She fell in love with you. I could tell by the way she turned color. Oh, and there was a look in her eyes. She has beautiful blue eyes, no? You see, she's very modest, and that is why she ran away. Did you fall in love with her?
Of course not.
Are you sure?
Look, Ma, I object to this old country custom of parents arranging a match.
Hmm? You know a better way?
Oh, we've had this argument before. I am not going to marry Miss Benko, and that's the end of it.
Maybe. You say you're going to Trieste? Gavri, visit your papa's village.
I already told...
What, you're not proud of your papa?
Yes, Mama, but he was from another time, another world. Look, Mama, it's getting late.
All right, before you go, eat something. Here, come on, give me your plate.
Hey, take it easy.
So, Gavri, do you think maybe you can find time to visit your papa's village?
Look, Mama, I really...
A pity. It might do you some good.
And that's how it would go each time I would visit my mother. There was usually a girl who she would have maneuvered into the apartment somehow on one pretext or another. Although, I must admit that Neda Benko was really the best-looking of the lot. She did have the deepest, bluest eyes, but... I mean, she was so obviously wrong for me. Well, I had enough to do getting ready for my trip to Trieste, but finally I got squared away and got there ready to work. But the night I arrived, for some reason I can't explain, I found myself out walking near the docks. Clouds obscured the moon. There was a mist, a fine rain. It was hard to see anything. And then I heard the voice.
Gavri.
Yes. Yes, that's my name.
I can see you are Gavri. Gavri Karja.
How did you know?
You look just like your picture.
What picture?
So, Gavri, tell me, where are you going?
Well, you tell me, why is it your affair?
It is my affair because my name is Volk. And I'm concerned with these things. Also because with this revolver, I can kill you in the blink of an eye.
Oh, is this a robbery?
The word came from Gorvan that you might be here.
Gorvan? What? That's the village. It's my father's village.
And his father's before him, and his father, and back for more than 1,000 years.
Yes, but what about Gorvan?
Walk in front of me quietly.
Yeah, but...
Carefully. Patrols are out.
Patrol? Perhaps you'd better explain.
Listen, you're making too much noise as it is. Turn here, to your left. Listen. A patrol.
What?
Silence. Flatten yourself against the wall. In this fog, they may not see us. Remember, make a single sound, and I'll be able to make sure of you.
Hans! Friedrich! Come here! Schnell!
What language was that?
What language do you think? German?
Yes, that's what it sounded like. But why would there be German soldiers here in Trieste?
Are you sure you're all right?
Who are you?
I'm Volk.
Volk? And suddenly, I heard a loud burst of music. It blared at me from the open door of a waterfront cafe. The rain had stopped, the pavement was dry, the mist had disappeared as if by magic. All about me were bright lights and laughter, music, crowds of people. I mean, where was the man who had somehow materialized out of the fog? The man who called himself Volk. He was nowhere to be seen. Who was he? Had I imagined it? Probably. Well, the next morning, I was in our office with our local manager, Francesca Danilo.
I hope you're satisfied with our progress here, Mr. Carson.
And my report on the whole is favorable. I know that with the proper supervision, you could very well become our outstanding overseas branch.
Well, thank you, Mr. Carson.
Yes, I must say I hadn't expected to find a woman branch manager.
It's probably due to the war, Mr. Carson.
The war? That was such a long time ago.
So many men were killed, especially in this part of the world. It became necessary and natural for women to take over.
Yes, of course. I'll be leaving for home the day after tomorrow.
Shall I have my secretary make the travel arrangement?
Oh, thank you.
It's no trouble at all.
Yeah. Tell me, Miss Danilo, have you ever heard of a town called Gorvan?
Gorvan? No.
I mean, it's in the Kastendil Valley?
Oh, yes. There was very heavy fighting there during the war.
Yes, and have you ever heard of a man called Gavri Kaja?
Oh, yes. He was quite a legendary hero. Are you interested in the history of this part of the world, Mr. Carson?
Well, we're in business here. It's good to know as much as possible about the people, the customs, so forth. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. About this Gavri Kaja.
The Germans set a trap for him, but he escaped somehow. He later went to the United States, where he married and raised a family, I believe. I understand he died some years ago. I could find out more if you're interested.
No, thank you. I was just mildly curious. The next night was my last in Trieste. I had some reports to complete, and I was ready for bed before midnight. I had an early plane. I closed my eyes. I'd just fallen asleep when... Where was I? Certainly not in the hotel room. It appeared to be a kind of cave.
Get down. Get down, Gavri.
What?
Get down behind that rock.
Hey, you're that man, Volk.
Get down behind that rock or I'll shoot you here and now.
What are you saying?
What he's saying is clear as crystal and just as sharp. If Gabriel doesn't do as he's told, he's as good, or as bad, as dead. Something is happening to Mr. Gabriel Carson, or Gavri Kaja. He seems to be moving in and out of an extremely strange situation. He's a strategic planner by profession. But he certainly hasn't planned on anything like this. The second act, shortly. Life Begins at 40 was the title of a popular book of a generation ago. And why not? When life begins, there's always been a matter for speculation and debate. However, looking at it a certain way, it may be said that our lives began long, long before we were born. Our lives began when life itself appeared on this planet. In each of us, whether or not we may be aware of it, are racial memories that go back to the dim and long-forgotten dawning of mankind.
Where are we? Who are you?
Quiet. They'll hear you.
Who's going to hear me?
Shut up. Do you want to get us both killed?
Killed? By whom?
Now, crawl forward slowly.
Now, would you just wait a minute?
Do you want me to shoot you now?
What do you mean, shoot me now?
Crawl forward. Don't try to call out.
Where are we going?
You know where we're going.
No, I don't.
It won't help you to pretend.
Look, where are we going?
To Gorvan.
Gorvan. Suddenly, it seemed there was an explosion in my head, as if the very word had set off a charge of dynamite. Gorvan. What was it? Just the name of some obscure mountain village? I closed my eyes. I tried to clear my mind. When I opened them again, the cave, or whatever it had been, was gone. And so was the man named Volk. I was sitting upright in the bed in my hotel room. Hello?
Mr. Carson?
Yes?
This is Mr. Nilo.
Oh, Mr. Nilo? Oh, yes, Mr. Nilo.
Are you all right, Mr. Carson?
Am I all right?
Well, you said you'd be by this morning to pick up the reports on your way to the airport.
Yes, that's right, I did.
Well, it's almost noon.
Noon?
You'll miss your plane.
How could it be noon?
Well, suppose I bring the reports to the hotel and then drive you out to the airport.
Oh, yeah, that's probably the only way to do it.
I'll be at the front entrance in half an hour.
Okay, thank you, Miss Danilo. I jumped out of bed, showered, and dressed quickly. A bellman arrived to pick up my luggage. I followed him out of the room into the corridor, but... No, it wasn't the corridor of a modern hotel. It was a dark alleyway. I was sopping wet. A pelting rain was coming down all about me, and something hard was being jabbed into my spine. I turned around, and I saw the revolver.
Face the front.
Who are you?
Don't you know by this time I'm Volk?
Look, I won't move another step, not one more step, until you tell me what you want.
I'll shoot you.
Okay, go ahead, kill me, and then I'll wake up. This is only a dream.
You think it's a dream?
Sure, it's a dream.
And the rest of it, that was all a dream, too?
The rest of what?
Gorvan. That was all a dream, Gorvan?
Gorvan? What do I know about Gorvan? What do I know about Gorvan?
Mr. Carson.
What?
Mr. Carson, are you all right?
What happened? What am I doing back here in my hotel room?
Well, you were supposed to meet me at the front entrance.
Front? Yeah.
But
yeah.
You weren't there. I waited. I had them call your room, but there was no answer. So I came up to see
you. Yes. We'd better get to the airport, huh?
I'm afraid you've already missed your plane.
Mr.
Carson, you're obviously not feeling well.
Obviously.
Well, you're quite pale. You're shaking. And you're standing there just muttering, Gorvan, what do I know about Gorvan?
Yes.
Gorvan. I seem to recall that name came up the other day. Wasn't it the name of some remote village?
Yeah, that's right.
May I ask, what do you know about it?
Nothing.
Mr. Carson, why don't you see a doctor?
A doctor?
Something is bothering you.
No. I'm not sick.
Oh, but it doesn't necessarily have to be physical.
Oh, you mean that kind of doctor?
Well, perhaps you need a sedative of some kind.
No, I won't go to a psychiatrist. I mean, I don't know how these things are viewed in your country, but in America, for people in management positions, seeing a psychiatrist could be interpreted as a sign of weakness or incompetence.
I understand. Therefore, might it not be best for you to see a psychiatrist here, far from home?
Yes. I mean, something is happening to me. I don't know. It began as soon as I arrived here.
Can you be sure of that?
Well, it never happened before.
Perhaps it was something that was bound to happen at any time. A very good friend of mine has his office not far from here. I'm sure you could see him at once.
I knew I was being handled, maneuvered, and... Well, I don't take to that sort of thing, but it seemed as if I had no will to resist. And I was feeling terribly confused. So she telephoned her friend, and I went over to his office.
Mr. Carson, I am Dr. Zaro.
No, wait a minute. You're not. I know you. You're Volk.
Who?
Volk. A man named Volk.
Who is Volk?
That man with the gun.
Obviously, I am unarmed.
Yeah, but he waits for me in the dark.
Yeah, but it's light in here.
There's gunfire going on all around us.
I don't hear the sound of shooting, do you?
No, but you are Volk.
Why do you insist?
Well, it's the same voice, the same face.
I am Dr. Zaro, Dr. Isvan Zaro. Who is Mr. Volk?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
And what does he want of you?
Well, he wants me to go back with him to Gorvan.
Gorvan?
Yeah, it's a small village high in the hills.
And how would you, an American, know about it?
Well, it was my father's village.
Ah, and his name was Carson?
No, it was Karja, Gavi Karja.
I see.
What do you see?
Your name is also Karja.
No, it isn't. Karja was the name that was given to me, but Carson is the name I took.
Why?
Well, because I wanted to get somewhere. It'd be easier, simpler, if my name were Carson. And, well, that's all there is to it.
Continue.
With what?
Your story.
Well, I've told you the whole story. A man I don't know who calls himself Volk wants me to go back to Gorvan with him.
That's all he wants?
Yes.
Well, if that's all, why don't you go?
Because I don't have the time. I'm quite busy.
You don't have a day or two. When was the last time you were in Gorvan?
Well, I've never been there.
Well, then, how do you account for Mr. Volk?
I can't account for Mr. Volk. That's why I'm here, to see if you have the answer.
You're the one who has the answer. After all, you created him.
You're saying he's a creature of my imagination?
Are you saying he's real?
Well, he seems very real.
How many times have you seen him?
Three, four.
What are your plans now?
Well, I should be on a plane for home tomorrow morning.
And Mr. Volk?
Well, I hope I can just leave him here, where he belongs.
What if you see him again?
Doctor, we seem to have lost sight of my purpose for this visit.
And, what is that?
I had hoped, I had expected that you would tell me how I could avoid seeing him again.
But you will see him again.
Now, look, Doctor, I was hoping you could help me.
Well, unfortunately, there is no pill or medication. You will have to help yourself.
All right. Tell me how.
Go to Gorvan.
But why?
Because that's where the answer is. If there is an answer.
Have a most pleasant flight, Mr. Carson.
Thank you, Miss Danilo. You've been quite helpful.
I wish I could have been more helpful.
Miss Danilo.
What is it?
There he is.
Who?
Volk. By the information booth. Don't you see him?
No, I'm afraid I can't.
Don't you see that man?
in a sheepskin coat.
A sheepskin coat? It's July.
And a fur hat.
Mr. Carson.
He has a rifle.
Mr. Carson, you'd better sit down.
Don't you see him?
No, I'm sorry.
He's coming towards us. Don't shoot!
All at once, there was no information booth, but a huge rock. There was no waiting room, no airport, but a steep mountainside, and I was trying to climb it. I had a pain in my chest. My hands were bleeding, and he was right behind me with his rifle.
Move forward.
I can't.
Move.
Look, I'm tired. I'm hungry. I can't.
Move.
Is that the only word you know?
Move or be shot.
God, I wish he would. Shoot me. It would be a blessing.
Shooting is too good for you. Shooting is too sweet, too painless.
Why? What have I done? What have I done? What have I done? What have I done?
Mr. Carson.
What? Oh. Miss Danilo, something seemed to come over me just for a moment.
What is wrong, Mr. Carson? Is wrong?
I don't know. But I guess there's only one way to find out. Miss Danilo, could you hire a car for me, please? Gorvan was not on any map, but it overlooked the Castendil Valley. The roads were good. They wound through steep, jagged, mountainous country. It reminded me of the Adirondacks or the Rockies. And to add to the back-home feeling was the American music on the radio. There wasn't a single soul in sight for miles. Where was Gorvan? Finally, I saw the sign, a small stone marker. It pointed directly up the side of the mountain. So I shipped it into the lowest gear to start the climb. And then, did I hear voices?
Nach Osten Licht, bleib ruhig.
Germans.
Yes, they are Germans. Be quiet.
Soldiers.
Yes, they are soldiers.
Vuk, it's you. What are you doing here? Where's my car? What am I doing here?
Those Germans. What are they doing here?
You know what they're doing here, Gavrikarja.
Look, I swear to you.
Gavrikarja, they're waiting for you.
For me? Why?
To show them the way.
The way? To where?
Govran.
Why?
So they can kill every man, woman, and child in the village.
And at this point, all of us will have to wait just a bit until the third act. Mr. Gabriel Carson, or Gavrikarja, has evidently blundered into a situation which he can neither understand nor control. Whether he will ever be able to do either or both shall be revealed shortly. Is one of the great themes of literature. There are some writers who say you can't go home again. There are others who claim that none of us ever really leave. All we know so far is that our hero, Gabriel Carson, or Gavrikarja, is going to his ancestral home for the first and what might very well be the last time.
The Germans are waiting for me?
Yes.
But why?
So that you can show them where the people of Gorvan are hiding.
No, look, believe me.
Believe you, a traitor. Now be silent. If you try to call out to your friends, you're a dead man.
My friends? You don't understand. If you would only let me explain, a mistake, a terrible mistake is being made.
Is your name Gavrikarja?
Yes, but...
The discussion is over.
I can't believe it. Soldiers, German soldiers, why are they here?
You know why they are here. They invaded our country to enslave us.
All right, let's just keep our heads. There's a war, huh? What war, huh? What year is this?
You know full well what year this is.
Please tell me.
This is the year 1943.
No, that's impossible. No, I must be having a nightmare.
You think so?
What do I have to do to wake up?
Enough of this stupid conversation. Now move forward, quietly.
No. No, I won't do it. Huh. I'm bound to wake up.
You won't move?
No.
All right.
Suddenly, he raised the rifle butt over his head. I never saw it come down on mine, but a great white light seemed to burst through my head. And then everything became dark. After a while, I don't know how long, I was conscious of deep pains throughout my skull. I opened my eyes. I was lying on the ground. It seemed to be the floor of a tiny hut. I tried to sit up, but I thought the better of it. Oh. Oh. Where am I?
Where? In the mountains.
Who are you?
Well, you know who I am.
No, I... Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember you. You're Netta Banker. What are you doing here?
I live here.
No. I mean, what are you doing here in my nightmare?
Your nightmare? The whole world has become a place of nightmare.
Yeah, I should have woken up when... What's his name? Evoke hit me on the head, but... Oh, evidently, the blow only served to drive me deeper into this. Netta. Why am I dreaming about you?
Why do you insist on calling me Netta? You know my name is Darinka. Oh, none of this will help you, this silly pretense.
Look, why don't you humor me?
You disgraced your village, your people.
Would you tell me what I did?
You have such an innocent look on your face. One could almost believe you.
No, would you tell me?
Dushan, your cousin, the man I was supposed to marry.
Dushan?
He killed the Nazi officer, and Dushan also died. But the Germans knew that he came from Govan, and they decided to destroy the village and kill everyone in it. Why do you make me recite this as if you don't know?
Because I don't know.
But we were warned. So all of us left for this hiding place. The Germans offered a reward to anyone who would lead them to us. You turned traitor. But we found out. And before you could do it, you had to run for your life. We traced you to Trieste and sent word to Volk, who was living there. Now, what else do you want me to tell you?
It isn't true.
It isn't true that you agreed to betray us to the Germans?
No, it isn't.
It isn't true that even now they're waiting for you at Sorbush Valley to show them the way?
Do you want to listen to me?
No.
Now, look, in all fairness...
You can talk at your trial.
But...
The people are gathering now. In an hour, it will be all over.
With that, she walked out of the hut. I tried to get up, but now I could feel the pains shooting into every part of my body. What was I going to do? With every passing minute, it seemed to be less and less of a nightmare, but if it wasn't a nightmare, what could it be?
Gavri Karja, your fellow villagers have asked me to preside as judge at your trial.
Wait, it's Miss Danilo.
As the mother of Dusan Brankovic, our martyr, I, Elena Brankovic, accept that honor.
No. You're Miss Danilo, Miss Francesca Danilo. You know me. Then tell these people who I am. Well, tell them.
Who brings the charge?
I do. I, Darinka.
State the charge.
He was seen entering the headquarters of the Nazi regiment in the town of Kaljus.
I never...
Silence! You shall have your chance.
He was seen by witnesses.
I listened to the charge. I was fascinated. The way a bird might be fascinated by a snake. I was seen entering the Nazi headquarters. I was seen leaving.
Gavri Karja. What do you have to say in your defense?
I'm sick of it. I'm tired of it. It's a dream. It's gone on too long. All I want to do is end it. But how?
Since you won't speak in your own behalf, is there anyone who will speak for you?
I will.
Look.
Yes. It's been such a hard life for all of us. We freeze in the winter, we starve all the year. And so sometimes the temptation to give up the fight is almost too much for our human strength to withstand. Let us not shoot him.
What are you saying, Vuk?
Hasn't there been enough killing? Haven't they killed too many of us already?
If we don't kill him, how can he be punished?
He's already been given the greatest punishment a man can know. He has lost the friendship, the esteem of his village. From now on, he's an outcast. What woman will have him as a husband? What man will have him as a friend?
Let us vote.
There were about 100 people gathered around us. When she asked for those in favor of execution, practically every hand was raised. She nodded her head. 5 men armed with rifles approached. I was placed against a huge rock. The 5 men raised their rifles.
No! Don't shoot! You must give me a chance to say something!
You were given a chance. You didn't take it.
I'll take it now. Please, please listen. Look, everybody, I couldn't have committed this treason. Do you know why? If this is the year 1943, then I haven't even been born yet.
This is what you wish to tell us?
I was born in America. Gavri Carja was my father. Look at me.
Yes, yes, I resemble the Gavri Carja, you know, but only the way a son resembles a father. Look at me closely, all of you. Am I really that Gavri Carja? Am I exactly as tall? Is my face exactly the same?
The scar? Where is the scar? He fought with Dushan.
He fought with Dushan over you and lost, which is why he wants to betray us.
But where is the scar from Dushan's knife?
That's right. My father had that scar on his cheek. Is it on mine? No. Therefore, I am not my father. I am his son. And I have not yet been born.
We are mad. All of us are mad. We have been driven to madness by hunger and cold and fear.
Wait. Wait, Elena. Perhaps this is what we have prayed for. A miracle. Why is he here? Why?
I don't know. Oh. Wait. Perhaps I do know. Now look, my father saved the village, right? Which means he wasn't killed here. He led the Germans into a trap.
What kind of trap?
An ambush. Yeah, yes. Yeah, that was the story. He told the Nazis he would lead them to the hiding place of the villagers, but instead he took them to a narrow pass.
I know of such a place where a few good riflemen could wipe out a regiment.
Yes, the ravine near Jalvara.
Exactly.
Let me lead them there.
You?
That's right. They think I'll take them to where the villagers are hidden. But instead, I will guide them to the Jalvara.
Good.
Yay.
Now look, if this is the year 1943, the tide of war has already turned against them. They have lost 250,000 soldiers at Stalingrad in Russia. The Americans have already landed in Africa, Sicily, Italy. Next year, they will invade France.
Is that really true?
Believe me, yes.
Let the village vote.
They voted. To believe me, the ambush was prepared. I made my way to where the German SS detachment was waiting, and I reported to the colonel.
What delayed you, Gavri Carja?
They moved to a new place, sir.
You know where it is?
Yes, sir.
Lead the way. Remember, at the first sign of treason, you'll be shot.
Yes, colonel.
How much further?
Just beyond this ravine.
Move quickly. I don't care for narrow places.
Down, Gavri! Behind the rock!
You are listening to the Yugoslav American Hour, bringing you the disco music of the 1980s. And now...
It was a dream. It couldn't have been a dream. It happened.
It happened. I know it happened.
I managed to get up the mountain. There was a small, trim, neat-looking house. Beyond it, a few others. A church, a school, a few shops. This was Gorvan. I stopped the car, walked to the house, knocked on the door. A woman opened it. She was rather attractive, although no longer young. But there could be no mistake. You are Darinka?
Yes.
And, Elena, is she still alive?
Elena? No, she died last year. But who are you? How do you know me? Why do you ask for Elena?
Who am I?
Well, you seem familiar. I'm sure I know you.
Well, I have come to visit my father's village.
Oh, you are Gavri. Gavri Karja. Oh, come in, sit down. I'll tell everyone you're here. Oh, we will have a celebration tonight. Your father, he saved us all. You know about that, I'm sure.
Yes.
You look exactly like him, except for the scar. Oh, that scar, he got it because of me. He fought a man named Dushan. But the truth, I wasn't in love with either of them.
You don't look a day older.
Older than what? I'm 60.
Will Neda look like you at 60, I wonder?
Neda? Who is Neda?
Well, something tells me she is the girl I'm going to marry.
Good. And of course you will name the first boy Gavri.
Yes, of course.
Gavri Karja. Son of Gavri Karja. After all these years, you have finally come home.
Yes, Darinka. I have finally come home.
As Mr. Stevenson said, home is the sailor, home from the sea, and the hunter home from the hills. All things come home at eventide. There is no place like home. This is a theme that has entranced the poet since time began. Home, be it ever so humble, the magic is still there. And for all of us, it is the greatest magic in our lives. I shall return shortly. The old country. For everyone, there is an old country. A place that exists somewhere else. All of us are immigrants, no matter how long we have been in residence. And the memories of that old country, that other country, remain with us forever. Nothing, no one, remains fixed in one spot for eternity. One day our descendants shall pick themselves up and leave, just as our ancestors did. And this country shall exist in fond recollection as the old country. Our cast included Paul Hecht, Carol Tytel, Court Benson, and Joan Shea. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Your awful chairs and all your other possessions. Huh? Yes, like Kerry, like me, like Father. Huh? Father was one of your possessions, too. Huh? You owned him. He belonged to you till he couldn't stand it anymore, and he died. Well, I didn't kill him. Nobody can say I killed my own father. No, nobody can say that.
Boy, cut it out.
Because you did that. You cruel, you stupid woman. You sitting there so smug, so pleased with yourself.
Boy, stop it, stop
it. But she's done it.
Are you all right, Mother?
Yeah, she's all right, isn't she?
I don't know.
Why is she just sitting there?
Troy, I don't know. Mother.
Oh, do something, Carrie. Do something.
Shut up, you little idiot.
Don't you see I don't know what to do?
This is Tammy Grimes inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.